My name is Eric Zillmer. I'm a professor of psychology at Drexel University. But who I am is not important. What is important is I'm inviting you to be my guest for a talk on the psychology of spying, the secret world of espionage. Why are people so preoccupied with knowing? And why does the modern military value intelligence more than weaponry? Come join me. Secrets and spying. You have 10 minutes? Well, what I'm about to tell you is it's top secret. It's about the psychology of spying. Of course, you've probably seen many different movies. Casablanca, James Bond. And yes, it's true. We're all fascinated by the psychology of spying. But let me tell you the truth. First of all, human beings are concerned with safety. Throughout of humanity, we build castles and fortresses and bunkers because we're afraid. What are we so afraid of? A general I met, his name is General Shoemaker, he told me, this is the most dangerous time of our lives right now. You think it's true? If in fact it is, wouldn't it be interesting to know what our enemies know? What they think of us? How do we survive? How do we go about this? Well, if you look into history, there was a complete collapse of intelligence on December 7th, 1941, when the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor. We didn't know anything. If we did, a lot of things would have been different. Or think about the 1962 Cuban Missile Crisis, when all of a sudden Russian rockets were built and transported to Cuba with direct range to the United States of America. We didn't know about that. I just returned from the Normandy with my women's basketball team, and we visited Omaha Beach, where on June 6, 1944, the Americans and their allies invaded Europe, which was the beginning of the end of World War II. We kept that a secret as 350,000 troops invaded Western France. And then, of course, what about the Cold War? For 30, 40 years, the Russians, the USSR, were spying on us, and we were spying on them. It's been really a remarkable history about why is this all happening? Well, during the day, I am the director of athletics at Drexel University. But at night, well, you're still on a need-to-know basis. But think about this. The most single piece of important intelligence over the last 5 years was what? What was it? It was the location of where bin Laden is, our number one enemy, and we found him. Well, how is it possible that we got that piece of intelligence? Well, I would argue with you that in this day, in our global war on terrorism, that the essential tool of military is knowledge, not weaponry. Of course, throughout history, the first casualty of war is the truth. But what are the psychological tools of spying? They include counterintelligence, disinformation, deceit, double agents, propaganda, and flat-out lying. In fact, spying has been associated with every war, and unfortunately, even peacetime. You know, Philadelphia at one point was the capital, spy capital of the world, because during the American Revolutionary War, our first CIA service, so to speak, was George Washington. And he says, the necessity of procuring good intelligence is apparent, and no matter what, we need to have secrets and keep them as secret as possible. George Washington, September 5th, 1776. So let me ask you this. Why are humans so preoccupied with secrecy and knowing? Well, part of it is psychological. One theory is that almost all human beings at one point or another, want to put meaning on what things are happening in life. We call that attribution theory, and it suggests that humans want to explain events. Always. We always want to know why he didn't call, why is Donald Trump running for president, what's going on. We're always trying to make inferences about it. And this information is important because this leads to a judgment that might be adaptable. Information that becomes adaptable for us to act on. Attribution theory. The other reason is our brains. You know, our brains are as big as a bowling ball, weighs about 3.5 pounds. It's the only organ enclosed entirely in skull. It has 100 million neurons with 15,000 connections, with the possibility of interconnectivity of 15,000 with 16 zeros on it. There's more interconnections possible in your brain than there are stars in the universe. However, those connections we make oftentimes are about secrecy and trying to understand information. It's in the frontal lobes of the human brain that's always turned on, trying to understand what's going on. Is there an email that we need to know about? We're spying constantly on our friends and our enemies. Our human brain is hardwired for secrecy. Just think about when you're trying to make sense of the environment. You are trying to put pieces together. Sometimes you don't know what you're seeing. Pay attention to the screen. Can you see this picture? Do you know what it is? Let me help you. Here's a little bit more information. Can you see it now? Oh, a little bit more information, and now the word yield comes to the foreground. So this is how the brain works. It constantly tries to make sense of what's happening. Of course, right now, the United States, are we at war? Well, some people think we're at war. We call it the global war on terrorism. And we're fighting potential threats throughout the world, and we need to know where they are. And I have a picture for you that's been declassified a few years ago about how Al-Qaeda, the terrorist organization, how they communicate. You see how they communicate? It's all decentralized among themselves. It's very hard to find out what their secrets are. We have to find out their emails. We have to listen to their phones. Oh, is it legal to do such things? Well, that's what we're fighting about in the United States of America, trying to find out how much information can we get into on private citizens. Take some comparison how my athletic director's job looks like and my athletic department is organized. You see, that's the athletic department, linear. So theoretically, you could easily find out what the secrets are. You would just have to go into one of those cells. Athletic department, Al-Qaeda. Athletic department, Al-Qaeda. So this whole idea about getting to know what other people know is a form of military intelligence. I happen to have written a book on it called Military Psychology. I didn't think that the Chinese, the Brazilians, and even the Turks and the South Koreans would translate my book because everybody's interested in the psychology of spying. But what we've learned there, and I've written about this in a chapter called Survival, Evasion, Resistance, and Escape, is that we can tell people how to resist telling people secrets. You know, in World War II, we had big posters that said, loose lips sink ships. It's a little more complicated now. But the military is actually training people that if they were to get into captivity, how to manage not giving out intelligence, information that's important to other people and to our survival. I happened to get a chance to go to Guantanamo. And of course, you know, it's a controversial part of Cuba where the American forces are holding, well, in the past 700 detainees, now about 70. It's a political hot potato. But one of the things that I've learned about is how we go about trying to get intelligence from these detainees that would help us secure our country. It's a very controversial program. It leads from interviews and interrogation to harsh interrogation. And as you know, there's been a history between 2002 and 2005 of torture to get information out of these detainees. Wow, what's going on? I learned in Guantanamo that 40,000 pieces of mail are being intercepted each year to learn more about what the detainees are thinking and who are they writing. And so this has been a really interesting issue for the United States of America. You may remember Obama during his campaign promised to close Guantanamo, but here we still are. Interestingly enough, I brought a postcard along to Guantanamo, and since everybody was allowed to mail things, including the terrorists, I mailed a postcard back to my parents. Hey, Mom and Dad, best wishes from Guantanamo. Drexel recently has been identified as a site for university homeland security, and Janet Napolitano, who at that time was the Secretary of Homeland Security, came to our campus, and there are a lot of issues even our universities about secrecy. One is cyber attacks. How do we defend against them? Of course, others are where terrorists come into a university and create havoc. So Drexel has been identified as one of the centers of this activity. But let me tell you something now to close off, really. What is it about spying and about spies that is so interesting? You know, my favorite spy when I was a kid was Maxwell Smart. And I'm not saying, you know, that actor is like how the spies look. But if you study them, you'll find that spies actually are very stable. They have very little mental issues, health issues. They're really resilient to stress. They have a willingness to go undercover and endure ambiguity and stress and live in foreign countries. They have a lot of training and special weaponry and counterintelligence training. So a lot of the movies are correct about that. There is some paranoia. You got to be suspicious all the time about what's going on. So they're not, you know, friendly sometimes. They accept a degree of risk. It's a dangerous job, possibly. They're low in anxiety and depression. They can work in an environment that has a lot of stress, similar to athletes. They're very rule governed. They can't just go about doing whatever they want to do. They have to follow rules. And they have to have an ability to blend in. So they don't really look like anybody, you know, like who looks like a spy. They actually look like, oh, I didn't know he was a spy. They just live next door. And are typically not extroverted or neurotic. They're very, very stable people. So, you know, one of the issues that we're facing now, having told you everything about this in 10 minutes, is that we're faced with a mass surveillance program, possibly in the United States. Edward Snowden, when he became a whistleblower, or was he a whistleblower, or was he not a kid who wanted attention for himself? By the way, he's still living overseas. The United States is still trying to extradite him. But he revealed that there was a top secret U.S. mass surveillance program going on that's reading all of our emails and listening to all of our phone calls. And so this is really like very, I mean, a lot of people think it's too much. Is this what we need to do to understand all the secrets that are going on in our country? Well, in my research, I found out three facts the CIA doesn't want you to know. And of course, these are confidential. You can't share them with anybody. And the first one is that your personal cell phone number is... Hold on. I gotta go. I'm sorry. Have a good day.
A man who leads a life of danger. To everyone he meets, he stays a stranger. With every move he makes, another chance he takes. Odds are he won't live to see tomorrow. Secret agent man. That you find.